This is 3:25:15, and this is the pre-Bungee Lab discussion. So we have an object, just some random object, and it's got a force downward on it of gravity, and it's got some force upward on it, some applied force. Now, if this object was sitting on the surface, that force being applied upward would be what?
Normal force,
yeah. This is such easy review for you at this point. If that thing was hanging by a cable, what would the force upward be on it called typically? Force of tension. What if it's hanging by a bungee cord?
Force of bungee.
Force of bungee. It's a force of tension if the bungee cord is at full extension. We often refer to it as an elastic force because that bungee, we've talked about elastic potential energy a little bit, that bungee stores energy in the form of elasticity. And so if we have this attached to a bungee cord, we get an elastic force up on it. Now, if this thing is sitting at the very bottom of the bungee cord, it's fully extended, it's just hanging there, and the bungee's acting like a rope, we don't really have the possibility of it accelerating. Its acceleration at that point is zero. So we have, on the y-axis, a sum of forces y equal to zero, which is equal to ma, which is equal to fg plus fe. Okay? Well, what if it's traveling downward and then the bungee cord is pulling it back up? The idea behind bungee jumping. So if it starts to accelerate back up, this is no longer true. So now we have a sum of forces on the y equal to ma and also equal to the force of gravity plus the elastic force. Does that make sense? Okay, let's talk about this acceleration. If this object was falling downward towards the ground, plummeting towards its whatever, its bell, its earth, its death, its floor, its tarp, as long as it's traveling downwards, its acceleration is what? Negative. We've got a negative acceleration being pulled by gravity. Now, it may be being slowed by the bungee that it's traveling downward on. It may not actually be equal to negative 9.81 meters per second squared, but it's still traveling downward. At the point when it hits bottom and it gets jerked back upwards, what is that acceleration going to be? So if it's downward, it's negative. When it's being jerked back upwards, it's what?
Positive.
So when you're doing all your calculations, you need to find some way that the elastic force exerted on it will yield a positive, the amount of elastic force that the bungee can exert on it will yield a positive acceleration. You need it to bounce back up. Now you also need it to bounce back up at a very specific point in space. Okay? Alright, so we've got this idea, and we know that what we want is some positive acceleration. Not too much, but just something more than zero. We don't want it to go down and stay there. We want to solve for something that's going to give us a slight positive acceleration. Well, we know that this is mg. What's force elastic? This is something we haven't talked a whole lot about. This is something that, it's really a concept that sort of, it bridges what we did in chapter 4 with forces and what we're going to do in spring systems, which is the next thing we go into. And so it connects those two, and it connects them through elastic energy, through potential energy elastic. So it's a nice bridge between those two ideas. Well, you know that K for any spring is the number of newtons that it can store per meter that it's deformed. We've talked about that a little bit with elastic potential energy. When a spring is deformed by this many meters, it produces this many newtons of force. So the elastic force is just equal to its K value times how many meters Whoops. Times how many meters you deform it. So that would be delta x. So this elastic force is expressed as k delta x. Well, you're going to have a selection of bungees. You're going to have different k values for those different bungees. And you can also deform, you can allow those bungees to deform to different degrees. So you don't have to deform a bungee to its entire length. If you have a 10-foot long bungee, can you take only a section of it and use it? Yeah. If you've got a really long, low k value bungee, can you only allow part of it to extend and contract? Yeah. And you can look at what the maximum amount of deformation in that is. Okay. Your first task tomorrow will just be calculating k values. And then you'll start to use this equation to figure out which bungee you need and how far you are going to allow it to deform. So at this point, I'm going to pass out the lab packets from here. So the final result of your design calculations is you will have selected a bungee or two bungees. You'll know their k values. You'll know how much you're going to allow them to deform in order to deliver your flower bag to the top of that bell and pull it back up. Ding! You will videotape this. Those of you who did slow-mo video for the bridges, I'd love it if you could do slow-mo video again and share them with me so that we have... We're still working on that. So that's where you'll start. And I'll put up a few little tutorials on parts of the calculations. You'll need to write up your procedure for... If you have an A lab, you need to just jot down what you're doing to measure. If you have a blue or purple lab, what you're doing to measure K values. So just how you plan to do it. And most of you already put that on your pre-lab stuff. Okay, so based on that, you'll be able to compute the K value and displacement that you need to deliver your mass to a point in time without breaking it, point in space. And tomorrow you start calculating K values.